The following is an ABC7 sports presentation.
It is a sure sign that spring is here. When seeds and brackets mark the end of the basketball year.
Extremely special. It's just very special.
It's about Cinderellas and fairy tales and finding a way when all else fails.
The very first thing that runs through my mind is the Final Four. And then once you get there, you're not satisfied with being in the Final Four. You want to win a national championship.
It's survive and advance. Sometimes it seems by chance.
Anything can happen. One game, 40 minutes, anything can happen.
It's madness and sadness, but full of joy too. It's March. What else would we do?
A lot of exciting plays, a lot of exciting wins. End of the game, buzzer beaters. You know, it's exciting.
It's about Final Fours and never befores.
The NCAA tournament is the period that ends all sentences for coaches.
And things so sweet and elite, we always want more.
In their eyes see hope and passion and I want to do this and okay, I want to be with those guys.
It's full of podiums, picks and poetry, rebounds, rallies and rhyme.
It's college basketball at its best.
It's the NCAA tournament and it's time.
ABC7 Sports presents Beyond the Bubble with Tim Brandt.
The Verizon Center is all dressed up tonight and ready for the big dance. Butler and Old Dominion will tip it up in just about 15 hours from now. This time tomorrow night, Cincinnati and Missouri will be on the court right there at Verizon Center. And hi, everybody. I'm Tim Brandt. Glad to have you along as we go beyond the bubble. And tonight we think we have a championship lineup for you. Let's start with the Georgetown Hoyas. The G-men left for Chicago yesterday. The Hoyas are a number six seed in the Southwest region.
The Georgetown Hoyas are full steam ahead, albeit with one eye on their rearview mirror.
There has to be a healthy understanding of what happened last year, as well as you can't dwell on that.
A year ago, Georgetown was a three seed, but the Hoyas got shocked by 14-seeded Ohio University, one and done, and it still stings.
It definitely fuels us because we haven't won in the postseason, and it was last year, the year before, you know. We don't want to go out like that again.
The Hoyas will play the winner of the alphabet game, VCU, USC. They won't know that result until later tonight.
So what we got to do is just watch like double the film. We got to prepare for both teams. We can't jump the gun and figure out who's going to win.
The best news for the Hoyas?
I will play on Friday.
Senior guard Chris Wright is due back after having surgery on a broken bone in his left hand. The Hoyas went 0-4 with Wright on the bench.
He is invaluable to this year's team, to this group. And so, you know, we're glad that he's healthy.
Wright and co-star Austin Freeman have only one NCAA tournament win, and that came in their freshman year. Friday night, they'll go for number two.
Every game is a championship, and that's it. And you got to approach it like that, because if you lose, you go home. Win, you keep moving.
This is the 27th time that Georgetown University has played in the NCAA tournament. Britt McHenry joins me now. Let's talk about George Mason. I mean, folks, here we go again. The Patriots are still a sentimental fan favorite 5 years after making that phenomenal run to the Final Four. Here they are with a whole new cast of dreamers as they move on in 2011.
Absolutely. And you know what's so interesting about this team, Tim, is they respect the 2006 run, but they want to make their own identity, of course. Well, senior Cam Long has come a very long way from his freshman year, evolving into the team's scoring leader, averaging 15 points a game. Junior Ryan Pearson is right behind him. Pearson was even named an ESPN Player of the Week this season. But the real reason this Mason team is so successful is because its superstars stick together.
It's a moment that marks a season, a moment George Mason basketball has waited 3 years for. And on Sunday, they finally got to savor it.
It was a great thing, just sitting here in front of everybody, all our fans, and seeing that name pop up there is just a great thing.
Getting into the tournament is one thing. Where you land is another. And this time, the Patriots hit a milestone in CAA history.
To be a number eight seed and wear white uniforms on the first day, first time in conference history, that's really, really special.
No doubt everyone realized the importance of Mason's first-round opponent, Villanova.
As soon as I seen Villanova on the screen, I was thinking Puerto Rico.
The Patriots last played Nova back in 2009.
Three for the lead, and he knocks it down.
That is unbelievable.
Mason lost by 1 point and left Puerto Rico with redemption on their minds.
It was a very emotional thing. But now that we got the opportunity to play him again, I mean, just it gives us the opportunity to go out there and do it again.
Mason's coming off one of its best regular seasons, a 16-game winning streak, and a top 25 ranking. It prompted Ryan Pearson to tweet about his favorite song and new team anthem called Moment for Life.
Greatness is what we want to bring up. Wish that I could have this moment for life.
Lyrics is just great, and it just represents what we have going on right now.
In this moment, I just feel so alive.
But even a seemingly perfect season can show its imperfections. Mason was upset by VCU in the conference tournament semifinal.
Pretty dish for Burgess.
Now the Patriots start from scratch when it counts, knowing each game could be their last.
Hey, I'm just ready to start a new winning streak all over again.
That I could have this moment for life.
So, Britt, here we go again. Jim Larranega is special.
He truly is, and those players are so inspired by him. So we'll see what happens.
All right, Britt, thanks.
Still to come, Tim goes one-on-one with the legendary John Thompson.
I looked up on the wall, and I told some of the kids who were there that a banner, an NCAA banner, will fly on that wall.
Tim catches up with Coach K.
I got boom, boom, boom. I felt sometimes like I was getting boom, boom, boom.
And up next, from tragedy to triumph, the inspirational story of local star Nolan Smith.
The emotions hit, you know, doing something so spectacular like that, winning a championship.
When Beyond the Bubble returns.
It was 9 years ago the University of Maryland won it all in Atlanta. There's the Final Four floor, which proudly hangs at the Comcast Center. Recently, I talked to head coach Gary Williams about that title run.
Does it seem like yesterday for you?
Yeah, it goes quick. I think it's funny, when people judge you as a coach, and then you win a national championship, they judge you a little differently. The good way is they really think you can coach because you won a national championship. But the other thing, you set the bar awful high. People get where if you don't get there in the Final Four, maybe you didn't have as good a year as you should have had. So there's two sides to it, but I'll take the national championship and live with that.
Gary Williams says it best. March Madness is when college basketball reaches a crescendo. It's the possibility of making a childhood dream come true. The tension of a lose and go home reality with a national championship is the goal. For Duke's Nolan Smith, it's all that and so much more. Basketball is the main fiber of his family, with the sport and all of its successes in his DNA.
Number two, Nolan Smith.
Nolan Smith's career at Duke has been a family affair.
It seems like just yesterday I was, you know, getting dropped off by my mom and sister.
You know, it's been a wonderful 4 years. Really sad. I'm going to miss being down at the games and watching Nolan play college basketball. There's nothing like it.
When Nolan plays, home or away, rest assured, his mom, Monica, has made the trek from Upper Marlboro, Maryland to be there.
Just being at a game in Cameron with the Cameron Crazies, you know, I equate it to family. It's like going home.
Nolan was Duke's dynamo this season, leading the Blue Devils in points and assists, en route to being honored as the ACC Player of the Year and the National Player of the Year by some.
Nobody in our program in my 31 years here has improved more than him.
Nolan was a prep standout, finishing his high school career at Oak Hill Academy in Virginia. A shooting star since his pint-sized days, Nolan took after his dad, Derek. Derek Smith was an All-American at the University of Louisville and helped lead the Cardinals to the 1980 National Championship before going on to play 10 years in the NBA. After his playing career ended, Derek became an assistant coach with the Washington Bullets. In 1996, he and his family were on a team cruise when Derek suffered a heart attack and died at the age of 34.
And I look at all the pictures of you guys, and at the time you were like this with your dad. I mean, it must seem like it was yesterday, and then he's still with you.
Oh, yeah. It definitely seems like it was just yesterday where, I mean, I've obviously gotten older, and, you know, that was some years ago. You know, I was only 7 years old, but, you know, we've grown. And as a family, you know, myself as a person, as a player, and, you know, we've done a great job as a family.
And the tragedy that occurred in his life brought his mother even more to the forefront. And Monica is one of the most beautiful people you could ever meet. She has the biggest heart, and no one has that same heart.
The fight is within Nolan, you know, and I think I told him this the other day. Again, everybody has the will and desire to do what they want to do. And he's had it, you know, himself. You know, I just instilled in him hard work.
A decade after his father's death, Nolan, a prize recruit, and Monica decided that Duke and Coach K would be the best fit for Nolan.
He was somebody that I immediately felt like I could trust with my son. And, you know, he's military. I knew there would be some discipline there, and it would be someone, and I think he has all the attributes that his dad will have.
Has Mike, Coach K, been like a father to you while you've been down here?
He has. He's definitely been a father figure to me. You know, conversations with him or about anything and everything. You know, on Father's Day, those days when I need somebody there, he's always, you know, the first one to call me and, you know, be there for me.
And he says you've been that father figure for him.
Well, I appreciate that. Actually, you know, sends chills through me when you say that. Nolan and I have gotten very close.
The bond between Nolan and his extended family at Duke goes way beyond basketball.
Nolan is probably the most well-liked player around the country, the most well-liked player on our campus. He just has the ability to make a lot of friends because it's never about him.
I feel like that's my dad all over again. He's not above anyone else. He's a regular kid. He'll do whatever he can to help anyone, and he's my dad all over again. It's nice.
Last year, Duke won the national championship in Indianapolis, the same city where Derek and Louisville won it 30 years prior.
What was that like for you emotionally and for the family?
Oh, yeah, it was very, a very emotional time, you know, especially after the game. The emotions hit, you know, doing something so spectacular like that, winning a championship, you know, being a part of history where there's not that many father and sons that have won championships. And, you know, I just look for my mom in the crowd to see her smile, my sister. And
it was emotional, and, you know, it was special. It was, part of it was Nolan's moment, too. Right there on the court, they had 1980 champions, and he was able to take a picture right next to it.
Nolan hopes to cap off his career with a date at the Final Four in Houston.
Taking the court for each individual game, knowing that game could be your last, you know, you just want to play your heart out. You know, I don't want any game too soon before the championship game to be my last.
I don't think he wants it to end. I remember his last AAU game, he cried. So I can't even imagine how he's going to feel after, you know, leaving the team, Coach K, and the university.
And I told him, you know, cherish every moment because, you know, you'll never get this back. And if you get to that next level, the thing is, it's a business. And, you know, it's a whole different ballgame. And it's nothing like college.
Nolan Smith was the ACC Tournament MVP last weekend, averaging 18 points and 6 assists in Duke's 3 wins on their way to the title. Coming up next, Chris Wright and Austin Freeman almost missed out on being Hoya teammates. That and a whole lot more as Beyond the Bubble continues. Oh, yeah, baby. That was the scene Monday night as the Georgetown women got a bid to the Big Dance for the second straight year. They'll play Princeton in College Park. The Maryland women will play St. Francis of Pennsylvania in the first round as well. That's also in Comcast. If the Hoyas and Terps both advance, you got it. They would meet in round 2. I'm joined now by Britt McHenry again. And Britt, the greatest thing about this tournament are the personal relationships, the players, the journeys they're on. A dynamic up close and personal with the Georgetown men's team coming up.
Exactly, and every team has one. Jordan, Pippen, maybe not quite at that level, but they could be well on their way. Well, we learned just how valuable Chris Wright is to Georgetown when he fractured his left hand last month, and the Hoyas lost all four games in Wright's absence. Without Wright, fellow star Austin Freeman just isn't quite the same, both on the court and in life.
They are Georgetown's dynamic duo, Chris Wright and Austin Freeman, co-stars lowering the curtain after a fantastic four-year run.
We had fun off the court, on the court. You know, we were very close friends, and I enjoyed it.
Freeman, Wright is putting on a show.
Wright and Freeman have brought out the best in Georgetown and each other.
I applaud what he's done since he's been here, and also having him on my team, he makes me better.
Each hails from the Washington area, and they go way back.
Probably we were 12, 11 years old, probably playing somewhere.
After playing together as youngsters, Wright and Freeman went their separate ways for high school. Freeman was recruited by and chose DeMatha.
You know, love at first sight, if that's what you want to call it. I mean, he was a special player.
Where he would star for the Stags and head coach Mike Jones.
He was one of the guys that kind of helped us kind of get back on track. He really just did a tremendous job of trying to fit in, but also making sure that when it came down to it, he put us in the best position not to lose.
Wright had an all-met career at St. John's College High School, one of DeMatha's biggest rivals.
Trying to contain him, that was our objective every time we played him.
After high school, they would reunite at Georgetown, but not immediately.
I was going to NC State, but you know, the coach left, Coach Sendek left, and, you know, so I rescinded my commitment. And when I opened things up, you know, Free was like, man, you got to come to Georgetown.
Whether it's Wright's leadership at point guard or Freeman's scoring, the Hoyas have pretty much gone as far as Austin and Chris have taken them.
We've been through a lot here. We've been through a lot of good wins, bad losses, tough losses, embarrassing losses, great wins. So, I mean, it's a great experience.
Now their stellar careers at Georgetown are almost over. Their next loss will be their last.
Hold on, let's not get this twisted. There's going to be a next year for us.
Professionally, yes, but not as Hoyas.
We're just going to try to take every game very serious, because it could end at any time.
Personally, me and Austin's goal since we've been here is to leave our own legacy. And that's what we're still trying to finish doing.
And the Hoyas are 0-4 with him out of the game. It's good to see he's back. They're saying he's going to play, right?
Absolutely. He spoke to the media, says he has range of motion, and he's feeling fine. He's ready.
Can he be 100%? I mean, will he be effective?
That's what he says. And he even told a bunch of fans on Twitter, hey, I know you all care about your brackets, but I'm going to be fine and I'm ready to play.
Look at Britt dropping a Twitter bomb on us. Thanks a lot, Britt. Really appreciate it. All right, still to come, I'll sit down with Duke's Hall of Fame head coach Mike Krzyzewski as he closes in on history. Beyond the Bubble continues. Stay with us.
You're watching Beyond the Bubble with Tim Brand.
Folks, if there is no passion in your life, then you really haven't lived. It's been said that if you find your passion, become it, let it become you, you'll find that great things happen to you and because of you. I want you to meet Michael William Krzyzewski, better known as Coach K. The Duke head coach has won 13 ACC championships, 4 national championships, and is currently the defending national title holder. He's in the Basketball Hall of Fame, and he continues to follow his passion. Mike, it's been a heck of a run. Yeah. Do you ever think about how fast those years went by?
Well, the first 3 years took about 25 years. So
you're only 2 losing seasons, by the way.
Yeah, but they were tough. And it's really about being at a place that you love, which attracts the level of player you need to do what you love to the highest level.
You made a comment once that really stuck with me. When you were in Chicago and as a little boy, you'd go back to Pennsylvania every summer.
Yeah.
And you said it kept your personality to keep you grounded and know where you came from.
Right.
What was that like?
Well, you know, I always feel like I'm the lucky guy, you know, in that I was lucky to to be born into that family that had the highest standards, maybe not a lot of money and material stuff, but never, we were never poor in anything, but we were rich in standards.
I mean, you've never lost that. You've never lost where you came from.
I think anybody who has success should always say, like, why you? Okay, if you're a great singer, why did they give you the great voice? Does that make you better than someone else because you can hit a baseball better than somebody? Does that make you better than someone else? No, you just, you have a talent. I was supposed to coach. I hit the jackpot. I went to the best school for leadership in the world, West Point, and while I was there, I played for the best coach in the world in Bob Knight. I got boom, boom, boom. I felt sometimes like I was getting boom, 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 but it was, I hit the lottery. And that's where you're lucky. It doesn't mean, but it doesn't separate you from being just another human being. Everybody's got good stuff in them.
Mike, and I know you're not tied up in the numbers, and I heard you and Bobby talking about, you know, it's the kids and it's everybody around you that's made it. But when you get to that number, which could happen this year,
right,
and you pass him and become the all-time winningest coach, can you put that in perspective?
I don't know if it'll ever happen again that the first coach over 900 is Coach Bob Knight. Okay, the second coach, unless health or whatever, will be me. I played for him. How can the first two and all the coaches in the history of our game to share that moment? To me, it'll be a shared great moment.
Does it ever get old?
Well, you have to make sure that you're in the moment of the team you're coaching. That's why I don't like to look back and somebody will say, how many ACC championships? I don't know. I try not, you know, regular season, tournament. Yeah, I do know we won four national championships because you're going to really remember those. I have to make sure that I'm about winning with this group, whatever group I have the privilege to coach at that particular time.
But even the most successful people in America, no matter what their business, once they have a successful marriage like you've had or three daughters in your case, the grandchildren in your case, I mean, it does seem to start to take away the most successful guys' drive on this side because now there's something even more important in their life.
I think one of the things, Tim, that is your commitment to the individual you're coaching. You know, in other words, I couldn't look Nolan Smith or Kyle Singler in the eye and see their passion without them looking into my eyes and them seeing my passion. It goes into their heart. Their eyes go to their heart. And their heart's young. Yeah, and their eyes see hope and passion and I want to do this and okay, I want to be with those guys. I don't want to be with the guys who are just sitting around having a glass of wine and talking about what they did. I want to be with these guys who are still trying to do.
More than several times you've had the opportunity to go to the NBA. And I mean, the money was crazy.
Yeah.
And you never took it.
Well, I make a lot of money now. You know, probably could have made more, would have made more in the NBA. So I've never made a decision for career for money. I figure you'll make money, you know, doing what you love to do, or enough money. And I think it goes back to my family in Chicago. You know, they were happy and they didn't make a lot of money. Now, it's better if you can be happy and make a lot of money. Don't get me wrong, but I don't think money should be the biggest factor in you making decisions about what you do with your life.
You've used your success and taken that and opened doors that success allowed you to open.
Yeah, well, thank you for saying that, but you know, I think as you go on, you ask why you stay hungry. Well, if it was just about winning, I've had a pretty good feast. Yeah, I mean, it's been a smorgasbord of everything. I mean, I've been lucky. There has to be more than just winning. What does that winning translate to? You know, can you build an Emily Krzyzewski Center? Can you still be on the V Foundation? Can you do something with the children's house? It gives value. Otherwise, I think you know, I'm not in a profession that operates on people or, you know, gives aid to people. it can be a calloused profession if you don't add some value, you know, if you don't use your platform well.
Mike, best of luck to
you. Yeah, thank you very much.
Head coach Mike Krzyzewski's Duke Club plays Hampton on Friday afternoon. Coach K is going after another record, 78 consecutive NCAA tournament wins. From one legend to another, former Georgetown head coach John Thompson is one of the most interesting, compelling, complex people you would ever want to sit down with. I'll do it on the other side as Beyond the Bubble continues. In 1984, John Thompson became the first African-American head coach to win a major collegiate championship when his Georgetown basketball team beat Houston 84-75. There is no question but the fact he did it his way and didn't seem to care what anybody else thought about it. Now the big fella is 69 years old and is a little bit more mellow. But I think to this day, the strongest characteristics of the man are his physical and moral qualities, which seem to compose his personality. Here then is my conversation with Big John Thompson.
John, how did you go from the Boston Celtics? I know then you were drafted, I think, in the expansion by the Bulls.
Yeah.
How did you get into coaching, and what was it that drove you?
Well, it happened by accident. Nothing drove me. It happened by accident. I had no intentions of being a basketball coach. I wanted to be a teacher, basically, social worker kind of person, freelance kind of thing. I enjoyed working with young people. One day when I was working in poverty program, the pastor called me from St. Anthony's, the parish in which I was living at the time, and asked me would I coach St. Anthony's high school team. And I told him I had to think about it. I'd go by the school and take a look at the situation. And I ended up telling him yes, and I was moonlighting. And it grew into my interest level coming to Georgetown and becoming the Georgetown coach.
And I heard you say once that Georgetown supported you all the way through. You turned that program around quickly.
Well, I had support from Georgetown, so no question. Some people at Georgetown, let me make that very clear. You know, it worked out. It wasn't easy. It was a very difficult thing because there are a lot of sociological entities that enter into it when an African-American gets a job at a school that wouldn't even take that African-American as a player.
John, Georgetown had won 3 games the year before you got there.
Yeah.
3 years, you're in the tournament. I mean, it was really a quick transition. In 1982, you're in the national championship game.
Yeah.
What was that like? How was that transition made?
Well, it was fun. You know, I couldn't begin to tell you how it was made other than a lot of people with hard work. You know, if you look at Georgetown even now, as far as physical resources, it doesn't have some of the physical resources that other universities have, but it has human resources.
John, I followed you a long time. I used to play basketball as a little kid down at Turkey Thicket, and I watched you play in high school. I was just 8 or 9, and you were in the Knights Columbus tournament with Carroll, that great run. I watched you make that transition. I watched you all the way through, and here you are now in the national championship. But the one that's an indelible memory for me is the 1982 championship game, and Brown throws that ball away. And you take a timeout with 2 seconds left, but at the end of the game, they take a shot of you, and you're face-to-face with Brown, talking to him, trying to console him.
You tend to know, if you've been working with people, that they feel just as bad as you felt. And first of all, I was a youngster at the time, and I was lucky. I could have emotionally reacted another way and still had the same feelings, you know, and that's why I feel that was a very lucky thing for me to have done, to walk over and to hug him.
You also have the other side of John Thompson. And it's not a bad thing. I mean, and a lot of people, and I'm talking about your players, have taken the wrath of John Thompson. It probably made them better people. Do you agree with that?
I am an emotional person. You know, I'm not, you know, I left to Giselle say once, and I agree with him 100%. When I go to church, I want the minister to be emotional. I don't want to go to sleep in church. If I'm being coached by somebody, I don't want to have a mummy. Yeah, so I didn't coach that way, you know what I mean? I show those emotions. A lot of times they probably were misinterpreted by players and by fans, but I was there to teach. I wasn't there to be somebody's friend. When you understand that, you're an athlete, and probably a lot of the people who jumped on your butt, you respect a hell of a lot more now that you're older than people who cuddled you.
Who got the first blow in? basketball.
You remember the game at Pittsburgh? Rafter and I are doing this game. Some kid throws an elbow at the end of the game. You take the kids, you walk off the court when the fight broke out. I mean, your guys wouldn't back down from anybody, and they wouldn't lose without giving it everything they had. And it came from you.
Well, yeah, it probably came from all of us in the environment. Probably sometimes we were too aggressive, too. You know, I think we probably had more impact on NCAA rules than any team in history. And I think about that, Tim, when I think about the job I'm doing now. Probably I would do my job a little bit different because I understand your job a little bit more. You know, but I never sat down and thought in my mind, I'm doing this just to mess with this guy, make his livelihood harder. And I think they thought I did that sometimes, but I didn't bother to explain it.
1984, you win the national championship. Tell me what that was like for you.
Well, it was great because from day one when I came into Georgetown in 1972, you know, I looked up on the wall and I told some of the kids who were there that a banner, an NCAA banner, will fly on that wall. You know, and I was young and dumb and stupid for even saying that. I didn't make a public announcement about it, but I felt that we would win. And I dedicated myself to winning. Well, in 1984, that was the fulfillment of one of my goals and my objectives. It also was very significant to me because I was an African-American in doing it. And not the fact that I was the first, but the first who was provided with an opportunity and accomplished it. And I think that had to mean something to me because of the fact of what had historically happened in this country, and I don't want to go through all of that. But in the meantime, I was very well aware of the fact that that wall had been knocked down.
Up next, John Thompson on Breaking Down Barriers.
I'm glad I wasn't born white.
On the heroes in his life.
My father couldn't read or write. His name was John Thompson, too. He couldn't spell it.
And on the nation's so-called number one hoops fan.
You can't describe it.
When we return.
Welcome back, everybody. John Thompson went to integrated Catholic schools. As a matter of fact, I remember watching John play basketball at John Carroll High School when they ripped off 55 straight wins. But make no mistake about this. Washington was still a very segregated city, very much like the rest of the South. Racism was rampant, and John coached at a very white university, Georgetown. John Thompson never forgot who he was, where he came from, or the color of his skin.
I wondered what I would have done if I'd have been born white. That would have been a disadvantage. I wouldn't have had a cause. I wouldn't have had something that I could have jumped on somebody about. So I look back at it and I said, you know, the Lord does work in strange ways.
I mean, I guarantee you all that still motivates you, would me.
The thing about it is that I've never known, Tim, anything different. And I also had two people that loved me, the pieces. And I felt that was my strongest weapon that I went with, is the fact that my mother and father loved me to pieces. My father couldn't read or write. His name was John Thompson, too. He couldn't spell it. But he was one of the smartest people that I ever been around in my life, with common sense and his values and what he wanted. So I felt safe.
Nationally, do you ever think of the impact that you had for African Americans?
I never thought about it as much until after I stopped coaching. You know, and so many, and particularly African Americans, came up to me and said, thank you, older people. See, we've always been labor, you know, but we've never been management.
Right.
See, and that was to show that we could manage a group of people. So I thought about that, but I didn't think about it in the context that a lot of people have come up to me and said, thank you. And it's made me feel good, though, you know, because you don't sit down, not unless you're crazy, and think about, I'm some kind of leader, I'm doing this for my people. When folks do that, I run the hell away from them.
You've alluded to all this and how difficult it was and breaking down the barriers, but most of all, just being you. But when you sit back and you see Barack Obama as the President of the United States, what does that mean, like, for you and your grandkids?
Well, it means an awful lot. And you can't describe it because it's more of a feeling than it is anything else. I couldn't imagine the expression on my mother and father's face had they seen that man being the president. I would just love to have looked back, because they are the ones who went through most of the bull. I went through some, certainly, but my mother and father went through a hell of a lot more than I did. That's for a lot of people. A lot of people who made sacrifices, a lot of people who took a lot of crap. You know, and when you see that man there, that's gotta mean something very special. It gotta mean you have options.
End it with this. When are you coming back to coach?
Never. I'm like Chief Joseph. I will fight no more forever.
A very open, honest head coach, John Thompson, and I certainly appreciate his time with us. Hey, coming up next, a look back at Mason's monumental, mesmerizing run to the Final Four. You won't want to miss this. When the NCAA tournament begins, the announcers, all of us, use terms like Cinderella to describe the underdogs who overachieve and knock off the bigger, more traditional big conference superstars. Certainly that was the case in 2006 when the so-called experts called little George Mason a giant killer. Well, to be honest with you, GMU is not all that little. It's a big commuter school and has more than 32,000 students, twice as many as Georgetown. But still, when George Mason made that run to the Final Four, it was the most magical run in the 72-year history of the NCAA tournament.
It had all the trappings of a Cinderella story, with one mid-major exception. This fairy tale was indeed real.
It obviously was a feel-good story.
Like, unless you were physically there, I can't describe it.
I describe it, the run of the Final Four is the gift that keeps on giving.
George Mason's remarkable run to the 2006 Final Four began before the season even started, when head coach Jim Larrañaga summoned a sports psychologist to speak to the team.
And he asked the players to tell him what they thought they could accomplish, what their dream was for the season. And Lamar Butler said, I dreamt we got to the Final Four.
Like many a Hollywood script, this story had a rather modest start. A late season win at Wichita State put the Patriots in the headlines and into the top 25 for the very first time.
It's a great accomplishment, but hopefully it's not the last of our goals to be achieved this year.
Weeks later, George Mason was invited to the Big Dance as an 11 seed, its first NCAA tournament berth since 2001. The first stop, Dayton, Ohio, for a date with Michigan State.
Before we left for Dayton, I promised the players that I would have more fun than any other head coach, and I wanted them to have more fun than any other team. And I think we did.
An upset win over the Spartans, followed by another over number 3 seed North Carolina, and George Mason was in the Sweet 16. Glass slipper, anyone?
There's probably never been a better definition of the concept of team than the George Mason run to the Final Four.
Verizon Center, just 20 miles from Fairfax, was the site for the regionals. And after a convincing win over Cinderella wannabe Wichita State, the Patriots were in the Elite Eight. Just one win from the Final Four, Mason Nation was giddy and growing.
You'd walk across campus and you'd see four biocameras talking and say to yourself, gee, I wonder what they're talking about. You'd get closer and they were talking about the last game or the next game. Everybody was talking about it.
And then the song started playing and people started believing, hey, this is our destiny.
And what would a great movie be without a superb soundtrack?
Living on a Prayer.
Every time I hear it, it's like this, that George Mason song again. It's crazy.
I was born in New Jersey, and Bon Jovi only grew up a little bit down the street, so I know a lot of his songs, but that one in particular, yeah, it kind of stands out.
The Mason Pep Band's version of the 80s Bon Jovi hit, Living on a Prayer, took on a life of its own. More than halfway there, the Living on a Prayer Patriots had one more impediment in their path. Connecticut, the top seed, and perennial power. Save for a few UConn fans, Verizon Center was all Mason that day.
I remember a couple times in the huddle, Coach Hill was saying something, and I don't even know what he was saying because it was so loud. But I've never been in an environment like that. 20,000 plus fans screaming, you know, GMU.
With Lamar Butler leading the way, George Mason won in overtime. Yeah! The unthinkable had happened. George Mason was going to the Final Four.
An event like that had not occurred on a college campus at a mid-major, so-called mid-major school, since Indiana State with Larry Bird went in 1979.
On the Verizon Center court, an embrace that Lamar Butler can still feel today.
The hug with my dad, I mean, people don't know the hard work that we put in since the time I first picked up a basketball. It was basketball, basketball, basketball. I sacrificed a lot. My parents sacrificed a lot to make sure that I would be successful in the game of basketball.
On to Indianapolis it was, and after touching down, George Mason touched off a Final Four frenzy.
Come on over here. Come on over here.
How is this?
Great. You know, I'm filming everything, taking it all in. This is amazing.
A storyline straight out of the movie Hoosiers was playing out in the Hoosier State.
I can't find a word in the dictionary to describe it, but if I want to pick a word, I would say unbelievable, amazing.
Our players enjoyed being in the spotlight. They were very, very humble, but also very, very excited and very highly motivated to continue the journey.
In this real-life movie, there were plenty of subplots with family ties.
And I had yet to see my grandson, James, who was born in February during the season. And on April 1st, the day we played Florida, Jay and Andrea, his wife, flew from Italy and arrived at Indianapolis just before game time. And I got a chance to see my grandson for the very first time. So that was very, very special.
Mason's opponent, the foil in the story, was Florida, adhering to their own script. The Gators led throughout and won en route to the title themselves. After the game, Butler walked off the court in tears.
We should have beat Florida. Go to the national championship, host the trophy up, have a national championship ring on my finger.
While the run was over, the residual effects remain. 5 years later, and perhaps forever.
The thing that struck me the most, and to this day strikes me the most, is the pride. People felt good that they were part of George Mason, and we had become a brand name. Anybody who didn't know George Mason before the run to the Final Four learned George Mason during that month.
If you say George Mason basketball to people, they'll say, oh, the Final Four. Yeah. Oh, wow, we remember that. It was great.
We estimate that we got about $190 million of free publicity during the run to the Final Four.
There hasn't been a day that's gone by since 06 that someone hasn't approached me and said, I was at your UConn game when you made it to the Final Four, or I was in Indianapolis, or that was the greatest run in college basketball history. And so people remember it. It obviously was a feel-good story. And we love to share the George Mason story with anyone who will listen.
So we've given you a look back and a view inside some of the most successful coaches in the history of the game and one of the greatest runs you'll ever see. Now it's time to watch the tournament unfold. So check your brackets and enjoy the games. I hope you enjoyed our special because we, all of the names you will see here on the screen, sure tried to take you beyond the bubble. I'm Tim Brandt. Good night, everybody.